Hi, welcome to my channel. I'm Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram. In this video, I would like to present a few key points in relation to thermoregulation in the neonatal unit. So obviously this video is designed to help nurses, advanced nurse practitioners and junior neonatal unit team members, doctors who might be involved in the care of the newborn. So obviously, each unit has a different way of doing things, so I'm not saying that there is only one approach. The main idea is to understand the concept of how things work. So thermal support is very important right from the delivery room, and when you go for a delivery, we should make sure that the labor room temperature is set appropriately. We do have NRP guidelines for that. We should have appropriate tools that help to bring the temperature up the newborn when you attend the delivery. So preventing hypothermia right from the labor room is very important. We need a plastic bag for the very small babies when we go for the delivery, and my aim is not to cover the delivery room management, so we will straight jump to thermal support in the neonatal unit. So we have three different equipment. I mean, the open care system, incubators and crib care. Crib care, of course, only comes into play for the stable babies who are clothed and are wrapped well. So there is no real thermal support coming from the crib. And so it's more for stable babies. When we come to open care systems, so these are systems where the radiant warmer is used to provide heat. And the main advantage is obviously to have easier access for procedures, and they're easier to clean. It is not possible to humidify effectively in the radiant warmer, even though some units use a cling film shield as an option. This limits the access. You have to remove the cling film every time. There is a small chance of accidents from the cling film. So open care systems are not used for routine baby care in the Western units. In the developing world, where resource limitation makes you have more of open care systems, these are cheaper, obviously. They are less difficult to manufacture, and the items involved are fewer. So it's a cheaper system, and most of the units in the developing world often use open care systems for the stable babies, for the bigger babies at least. And the disadvantage is obviously the lack of ability to humidify and the wind rot that may be associated. So my unit has a few open care systems. We use it more for procedures. We transfer the babies to that, or before we move the baby to the crib, we keep them in the open care for a while. If they do need some additional support, we keep them on the pre-warm mode for some time, and then we transition them down. So these are usually bigger babies. If it is a premature baby, in the first few days, their skin is obviously not mature. So even if it is a 34 or 35 weeker, receive them in the incubator, even if you are in a unit with resource limitation. So this is the open care system. And as you can see, we have the radiant heater at the top. You may have the resuscitator options in the open care systems, mainly those used in the labor room. But those used in the NICU, you may or may not enable them, as you will have the NEOPUFF and other devices attached. These side rails are very important. Don't forget to close them, and there is an ability to tilt the system as well and lower the unit up and down. So we have three main modes on the open care system. We have the skin mode. So this can be used soon after admission for monitoring a baby. For suppose a baby has a brief transient tachypnea of newborn, you expect the baby to settle down within a few hours after the delivery and you plan to shift. So it's easier to clean the open care system, and it's a term baby, so there is no harm in receiving the baby and keep them on the skin mode in the beginning, because the temperature is labile soon after delivery. And if you fix the probe appropriately, the skin mode is handy to adjust the level of heat. Air mode or manual mode is an option as well in the open care system. The main difficulty with the manual mode is that you have to monitor the baby's skin temperature yourself and make adjustments in the heater output. So if you look at the design of a panel in most of the radiant warmer systems, you have this area where you have the extent to which the heater output is used. So we have from 10 marks in most of them, so from 10% to 100% heater output. And if there are no lights on here, it means there is no heater output heat emitted. And if you have 5 marks, it means 50% of the heater output is on. Usually when you go to the labor room, we have kept the warmer there on a pre-warm mode, so that the towel and everything kept under it is kept heated. However, when you are actually attending the delivery, it's better to change it to the manual mode, because the pre-warm mode keeps dropping the heater output every few minutes, and it reaches 30% and stays there. When you are bringing the baby back to the unit, so obviously air mode alarms every 15 minutes for you to check the temperature, so keeping them on the air mode is not a suitable option. The pre-warm mode is useful for babies where, I mean, one is in the labor room where you are preheating your equipment and you want them to stay at a certain temperature. Once the baby is moving out of the incubator, before transitioning to the crib, if we need a little bit of heat, the pre-warm mode is a good option. When you switch on the open care system in a pre-warm mode, it starts with 100% heater output, and within a 10 to 15 minute period, it drops to 30%. It stays at 30% heat after that, so it does provide more heat than what is there in the environment. So this is in contrast to the crib. It doesn't overheat the baby, because 30% heater output just leads to a little bit of warmth, and a baby can be wrapped more if the 30% isn't enough. So if you keep that same baby on manual mode, if the baby is a bit cold, and increase the heater output to say from 30 to 50% for a few minutes, the body temperature catches up, then they may again be able to maintain in pre-warm mode with a little more wrapping. So this is a tip for you to transition from incubator to crib care. You can use a pre-warm mode. The pre-warm mode doesn't alarm, so it can be kept for any length of time. Skin mode on the open care system, one big thing that you have to monitor is that the probe is attached properly. If the probe is displaced, it will read the air temperature and baby will get roasted. So this is not good unless you are closely monitoring and the probe has been fixed properly. So I'm not a fan of the skin mode on the open care system, except for maybe the first 3 to 4 hours of age. A small baby who is growth restricted or who is premature under 35 weeks should not really go under the open care system in the first few days. So this panel, again, you have the ability to monitor the temperature, ability to adjust the mode that you use, and so on. Coming on to incubators, so these are a key equipment that has helped us manage the premature babies as well as we do now. It is essential for any preterm baby with thin skin which is at risk of insensible water loss. So even if you are not using the humidification function, the wind draught as well as radiant heat both are negative, so open care systems are not ideally suited. The incubator humidification is effective because it's a closed chamber and the relative humidity within that chamber can increase significantly, up to 90% in many cases. The air curtains, like in the air boost function in the giraffe, helps to increase the air circulation, so it causes an air boost curtain when you open the doors or the side doors or the windows. Side ports or the windows in the incubator. If you want to do a certain procedure or you want to examine the baby, you turn on the air boost function so the air doesn't escape outside or the outside air doesn't enter that easily, because there is a faster airflow, particularly in these cases. The other important aspect is, because of this air curtain, the humidity inside may not drop as quickly. When we have a giraffe or an advanced incubator of similar sort, they do have a radiant warmer mode. So you can receive the baby in the radiant warmer mode in the labor room. You can close the incubator and bring the baby. You can switch on the humidity even as you are moving the baby. So this is a big advantage. Many units often use the radiant warmer mode for procedures in the same babies. When it comes to the extreme preterm, obviously, humidification is very important. Exposing them to radiant heat alone without humidity is quite damaging. So even if you are doing a procedure, try to learn to do it within the incubator as best as you can. It can be challenging. It needs some training, especially when it comes to asepsis and a sterile field and not to touch the sides and so on. You may need help. You may need an extra hand to give you things, but it does work. And I have done procedures through the incubator, umbilical lines, long lines and so on as well. So if you are unable to do it and you do need to open, consider using a plastic bag for the duration, because at least the local area the baby is under the warmer will have the increased relative humidity. It's the same principle as using the plastic bag in the labor room. And when you bring in such babies, if you're doing procedures in the warmer mode, don't remove the plastic bag till the procedures are done. You can expose the area that you need to do the procedure under. So these are illustrations of the giraffe incubator. I'm not advertising any brand, but this is quite a good piece of equipment we use. And obviously the panel is on the top part. Most of the older incubators have the panel on the side, and you have quite a few adjustments. So this is the air boost option that I mentioned. The fan speed is indicated here, and the skin mode versus the air mode, and if you want the radiant heater option. So humidity is reflected here, and you can go up to 90% humidity. This is the radiant warmer mode of the giraffe. This top will come down and it closes to become an incubator mode. So a brief mention of humidity. So the reason we use the plastic bag at delivery is obviously to increase the relative humidity around the baby. And what do we mean by humidity? It's just the extent to which the water vapor is there in the environment surrounding us. When we have a high relative humidity, the evaporation is reduced. So the insensible loss from the baby is reduced because the air cannot take in much more water vapor. It's already saturated with water vapor. So when you have a plastic bag and the baby is received under the warmer, the baby does lose water vapor in the beginning, but it stays within the plastic bag. So it inhibits further water loss from the insensible loss. We should remember that evaporation produces cooling. So when the baby loses water from the skin, there is cooling associated with it. And this cooling makes it more difficult to maintain the baby's temperature. So when you actually humidify, it works like magic that you can actually maintain the temperature of the baby. For the same reason, if a baby is struggling to maintain the temperature, when you start dropping the humidity, you put it back up. You monitor the sodium, you monitor the weight of the baby. If any of these are problems in the first few days in an extreme preterm, always play around with the humidity, increase it. Don't hesitate to keep it high if these issues are happening. If a baby is stable and shows evidence that the air temperature needed is coming down, you can start weaning the humidity and gradual process. In 90% humidity is started in the extreme preterms. You may leave it at 90% for the first 5 days or so, and then try reducing by 5% at a time. If you are unable to successfully do it, that is, a baby shows an excessive weight loss or you have a rising sodium, you may keep it on the same and more gradually reduce it. In a 28 to 30 weeker, for example, you may start with 80%, and when you reduce 5% every second or third day, you again monitor as tolerated. By the time the baby is 10 days or so, in these cases, you may be off humidification. We should monitor the need for humidity based on the temperature requirement, serum sodium, and the weight loss. And the weaning should be individualized. There are always babies who may need a certain amount of humidity at a certain time, more than what you expect. So this is to illustrate a plastic bag I had for the baby at delivery. And this is the humidification chamber. The water should ideally be changed every day, so we don't have any risk of infection from the humidity itself. We don't see any cases of Pseudomonas sepsis in the NICUs, thankfully. Coming to the modes on the incubator, we have the skin mode or the servo mode. I know most of the intensive care units in the US as well use the servo mode to start with. But I have a couple of facts against using it as a routine. Of course, in the first 48 to 72 hours in an extreme preterm, the maintaining the temperature is a big challenge, and the servo mode is going to help maintain it better. But beyond that stage, and in older premature babies, for example, more mature premature babies, you may keep the servo mode for the first day alone, and then you can change to the air mode. The advantage of using the air mode is you're more fine-tuning the setting. The nurse is more actively involved, and the chances of overheating the baby is less. So the probe displacements may cause overheating in the servo mode. And if you compare the required temperature to maintain the stable body temperature in the same baby, you can try experimenting in your unit. So keep it on skin mode and see what temperature in the air the baby is needing. Suppose a baby is a premature baby at 28 weeks and is around 3 days old. The temperature showing on the skin mode may be 36 for the air temperature. So don't confuse it. The skin mode also heats the air in the incubator. So the measured air temperature is the actual air temperature that the baby is needing in the environment. The skin temperature is measured by the probe, and that is shown on the left hand side in the giraffe, for example. So you compare the air temperature and you switch the baby to air mode. you keep the temperature at the same level and gradually reduce it, and you would find that the baby is maintaining at say 1 degree less after a few days. So this difference also makes a difference, because increased heat actually affects the metabolism. The basal metabolic rate is higher. Just like hypothermia is harmful, having a higher temperature in the environment may increase the risk of apnea, and you may lose more water due to insensible losses when the temperature is high. So if the baby can maintain with 0.5 to 1 degree centigrade lower on an air mode, why don't we use it more regularly? We do use that in our unit. One thing that we should note in both the modes is that don't rely just on the skin probe on the baby for the temperature recordings. Sometimes the probe may fail or it may be displaced. So we should have a regular manual measurement as well every 6 hours or so, along with your cares. So incorporate it into your setup. So when are we ready to move to crib care? So when the baby has clothes, once you're off the humidity and you have clothes on the baby, when the baby's respiratory support has been weaned, we have low requirements consistently on the incubator on the air mode. So around 28 to 29 degrees centigrade with medium clothing and wrapping should be adequate stage when we can move the baby to the crib. Ideally, the baby should show a good weight gain, and the baby should be clinically stable. And as I mentioned, we can consider keeping the baby on the pre-warm mode in the open care system for a couple of days and then transition to a crib. So this usually happens in the step-down unit if your NICU has a step-down unit. So I hope this short discussion on thermoregulation focusing on use of open care and incubator in the NICU is helpful. And do subscribe and share. And again, turn on the notifications when you subscribe so you do receive a notification when the next video is released. If you would like to comment or share the practice that you use in your unit, please mention in the comment section. The more interaction we have, the better. So again, I would like to thank you for patiently watching this. I hope you liked it.